So in this video, I'm going to show you guys how to make use of Simulink. So here's a basic Simulink model. Now I'm going to start assuming it hadn't been loaded up. So if I were just in regular old MATLAB, I could go to Open. And I could go and navigate to the directory where I have my model. So I'm going to open this one, DC Motor Basic. That's the one I gave you guys. Now it's going to load up, I think, relatively quickly on my machine. Yours, it may load up much slower, and the reason for that really is because I already had Simulink open. The first time you open Simulink from within MATLAB, it is very slow. All right, just be mindful of that. All right, so this is our basic DC motor model. Now, this actually makes use of two different things. It actually uses Simulink and something called Simscape. And Simscape is really meant for simulating physical systems like motors, so mechanical systems, electrical systems, fluid systems, you know, whatever. This guy's meant for doing all of that. So what you actually see here is something like the step function, sort of a native Simulink function. And this guy here is a converter that goes between Simulink and Simscape. All right, now you guys are going to, I'm going to gradually ease you guys into using stuff like that. In this particular case, I'm giving you guys the model. Later on in the semester, you guys will be making modifications to this basic model and adding stuff in. So you'll have to start thinking about that later. All right, but anytime I go between a Simulink block and a Simscape block, I have to have one of these converters. In this case, going from Simulink to Simscape. Here, this guy goes from Simscape to Simulink. Alright, I don't need to say a whole lot about this, but let's make some sense as to what the picture is that we're looking at here. This guy here is a Simscape block, and he's a controlled voltage source. Alright, if I want to find out more about him, I double click. Alright, tells me, okay, this block represents an ideal voltage source, powerful enough to maintain the specified voltage at its output regardless of the current passing through it. Right, so that means effectively that this guy is an ideal voltage source. The output voltage is V equal to VS, where VS is the numerical value presented at the physical signal port. So in other words, the output voltage is what's presented at this point right here, the physical signal port. So the value of this guy comes from the step function. Okay, so if I look at this step function, I double clicked on that. So just let me do that again. So if I go on this guy, double click, opens up the parameters. So for the step function, I see there's really three critical parameters here. And you really shouldn't be messing around with anything else other than these three critical ones here. The step time, so in this case it says the step is applied at time t equal to 0. The initial value, which is 0. And the final value, which in this case is 3. Which means that I want this controlled voltage source here to apply a 3-volt step. If I wanted a 5-volt step, I'd type 5 right there, hit apply, and OK. All right, let me leave it at 3. So 3, apply, okay. All right, now, that voltage source, if we look at it carefully, so current would flow through this source, like this, then into the current sensor, and then to this VA plus terminal. This guy here is my motor. So current that flows into the VA plus would throw through the motor, out the VA minus terminal, and back into this source. Okay, this guy is a sensor. All right, the idea of the sensor is to measure the voltage between these two points, and what comes out is a signal that I convert to from Simscape to Simulink. Once it's in Simulink, I use this thing called an oscilloscope, which allows me to see what it looks like. So here is my oscilloscope. So I'll deal with that in a second, trying to use the oscilloscope and make some measurements. All right, now here I said was my motor, right? The motor on the blue side is the electrical terminals. The green side is actually the mechanical terminals. So you see that connected to the R and C, which are the mechanical terminals, I have my ideal rotational motion sensor. That's my tachometer, right? And if I click on that, I can find some parameters. I see this guy can actually output to me a W, which is an omega, so in other words, a speed, and also output an angle, okay, if I'm trying to do position measurement, which we'll do later, okay? All right. Couple of things. I see that voltage measurement is across, current measurement is through. All right, and that sort of makes sense. So let me open up my motor. Maybe before I open up my motor, one thing about this, there's this solver configuration thing that I always need when I'm using Simscape. Don't touch it. Usually you don't, I mean, the models should converge unless you do something strange. All right, this guy is set up so that the models will converge. Okay, so don't play with it. You shouldn't be doing anything that's gonna cause it to not converge. So again, this block subsystem I said contains my motor. So let me double click on it. Okay, open this up and I can see, well, here's my motor model. Here's the electrical side on the left. Here's the rotational side on the right. All right, it's actually set up kind of using what we refer to as sort of a circuit analog for the mechanical system, right? That's not too important, but let's kind of look at the individual values. Once you've run your stuff in problem four, you're going to get values for things like the L and the R and the KM and things like that. So here, if I double click on the inductor, okay, I see that the inductance is 0.001 Henry's by default. Okay, I would put in my value that I got. Similarly, if I double click on the resistor, one is the default. I should actually put in the value that I found. This rotational electromechanical converter is basically my back EMF source, which represents the energy conversion from electrical to mechanical. So torque equals KI, V equals K omega. Here, what it's looking for is K. So this guy's defaulted to one, like we said. So over on this side, I said I had this circuit analog for the mechanical system. So this is the moment of inertia. So this is where my J value would go, my moment of inertia. Again, a default value is in there. And then this guy here deserves a little bit of discussion. This is the load torque, which is written as rotational friction. And you see it takes some weird parameters. Breakaway friction torque, breakaway friction velocity, Coulomb friction torque, viscous friction coefficient. To understand that, if you want to get some details, I talked about it, and I have some details about it in the notes, but here's the documentation page that's available on the web, okay? So it shows us, okay, well, here's that same picture, right, the rotational element. And this block sort of tells me, okay, well, what this guy can do, and again, this is showing the notes we talked about in class. It shows this friction block, where essentially Coulomb friction is sort of the constant value that's always here. Viscous friction is this sort of speed-dependent component of the friction. And really, that's usually sufficient, is to say that I've got this constant portion plus this beta omega. I said that's the model that we're really using. Now, this guy is meant to be a little bit more advanced, and it includes this thing called the Strebeck effect, which says, and it's real, it does happen, but it's not that significant. Basically says that there's a very high torque called the breakaway torque, all right, that happens as I start to move. Then the torque actually decreases a little bit as I start to move and then starts to rise. All right, this value here, this sort of Strebeck effect is really, really negligible. All right, we can include it, but there's no reason to do so. All right, so looking at that picture and looking at these values over here, the way that I did this, and you'll see that it works, should work just fine for you, is I set the breakaway friction torque and the Coulomb friction torque to be the same, okay? In other words, the value of T sub zero that you got in problem four should be both the breakaway friction torque and the Coulomb friction torque, all right? The viscous friction coefficient, this is your beta. This would be your T0. This would be your T0. And then this guy, your breakaway friction velocity. Basically, that says, really kind of talks about at what point does the breakaway friction torque and the Coulomb friction torque become equal to each other. All right, that's not too significant. What I recommend doing is I set it equal to a really low value, like 0.01 radians per second. That should work fine, all right, if you do that. All right, so you may want to study this picture a little bit to really understand this. But if I set this guy up the way I have it here, where I put the breakaway friction torque and the Coulomb friction torque at the same value, and you look at this picture over here, what you see is that takes the gets rid of the Strebeck effect. So it pulls this breakaway friction torque down so it aligns with the Coulomb friction point. All right, and effectively what that does is it gives us a constant plus a speed dependent, a linear speed dependent term, okay? And that's basically how you guys will enter that. So apply, okay. Now, one thing real quick, I wrote down T0 and beta. You guys are obviously going to put in real numbers for that, okay? When you're done, you're ready to simulate this guy. Now, I'm going to simulate my own here real quick with my real parameters so that it'll actually work. All right, so here's the setup. I think I've set this up for a 3-volt step, okay? And one thing I'm going to do before I do this is I want to look at the data that comes out of this for comparison purposes in real MATLAB, okay? So I'm going to open up this, for instance, this guy here, the current. I'm going to go to View, then down to Configuration Parameters. I go to logging. All right, this guy allows me to be able to send data to the workspace so that I can play with it. All right, one thing I want to make sure is unchecked is this limit data to the last 5,000 points. I want all of the data to come out for comparison purposes. I want to make sure that the decimation is 1. So in other words, it's not downsampling. It's not decimating. And I want to log data to the workspace. I'm going to put it into this structure with time called current. Okay. Say OK. And minimize my oscilloscope. And I'm going to do the same thing for the RPMs. So I double click on the RPM, go to View, Configuration Parameters. Again, go to Logging. Make sure that I'm not limiting the data to the last 5,000 points. So make sure this is unchecked. Make sure the decimation is 1. Make sure I'm logging data to the workspace. In this case, I'll kind of RPM1, and I want it to be a structure. Okay. All right, now that's all ready to go. So two structures should be created, one called RPM1 and one called current. Okay. So I'm going to run this. I run this by clicking this button. It initializes, terminates. Okay, yeah, and he's done at that point. Okay, so now if I want to see what the data looks like, click on the voltage there. All right, one thing I can do is if I need to play with the, I can click this sort of zoom to fit to make everything fit in here. And I can see, well, the voltage is pretty uninteresting. Basically, from time t equals 0 to time 10, this guy is basically sitting at 3 volts. Okay, so the voltage is kind of uninteresting. Let's look at the RPM. All right, when I look at the RPM, I see, okay, this guy does sort of what I think it's going to do. He rises up, and he levels off. Okay, and I can click on this guy here, the cursors. And then I can use my left mouse button to move this cursor around. And you'll see that on the right side of the screen over here, it tells me that at the location of this cursor, the speed is 97 RPM. And I can move the second one as well. All right, so it tells me things like the delta T between those two cursors, and it tells me the value at those two cursors, and the delta on the y-axis between those two cursors. Okay? A relatively useful thing. Now, in addition, if I were to go to my actual MATLAB window, I would see that there is now this structure called current and this structure called time. Now, if you want to know more about structures, you can do that in MATLAB or go online and look more about them. I'm going to explain them to you here real briefly. All right. Looking at this, what I see All right, is that I have a time vector inside the structure. Structure is sort of like a class, I guess, if you will, in object-oriented programming terms. So if I look at this, let's say I wanted to look at rpm1.time. So rpm1.time is a vector of time points. Okay. Now there's the signals associated with it. So I can say rpm1.signals, and I see that that contains a couple of different things, but apparently it looks like there's 95 points in this values column vector. So I can type rpm1.signals.values, and boom, there's the vector of data. Okay? So if I wanted to plot that, all right, what I'm asking you guys to do is to do something like this. Plot T, so let's do figure. Actually, I'm gonna explicitly run this. I have written a script to compare motor params 3-3 comparison. I'm gonna run this, okay. And what you see here is I've created and plotted on top of each other. So the red is the ideal from the simulation, and the blue is the actual data. Now this is at 3 volts, okay? And you'll notice at 3 volts, the effect of these disturbances, these ripples here, is the worst. The fits, I mean, this fits pretty good, to be perfectly honest with you, but the fit will get much better as you look at higher voltages. And the effect of this disturbance is a little bit more minimized. But you can see that the rise here still fits pretty well, okay? Now, if I look at the current, zoom in on it, you'll see that that rise time, you know, fits really nicely because of the way that we've gotten the inductance and such. Looks like I got a pretty good model. Now, I don't have the effects of these disturbances factored in, but that's pretty hard. I mean, I don't have anything in my model to capture those disturbances, so it's not too surprising that that would really sort of be the case. And maybe some other things that I would kind of point out. Notice that the red goes a lot longer here because I ran my simulation for 10 seconds, but I only collected about 3.5 seconds worth of data. Okay. Now to create this plot, right, notice I've got two things plotted on top of each other. Okay. The way you would do that, right, the way I created this plot, for instance, I can say something like this: figure 9, plot T I A current dot time. And current dot signals dot values, like that. So in other words, what this is saying is plot the time vector, or plot IA versus the vector T, and plot this current dot signals dot values versus current dot time. Plot that, and there you get your graph, right? And if you combine that with subplots, you get something like this. All right, so a lot of this assignment is really for you guys to get sort of comfortable with this stuff, and then we'll be using it ultimately for design going forward once we get into problem set 3. Okay, all right, so hopefully that helps. We'll have opportunities next week for you guys to ask more questions, and we'll go from there.